As we know, advanced chronic hepatitis C progresses to hepatocellular carcinoma in a significant proportion of patients. The general incidence number rate is about 2 to 5%. Cure HCV infection has been associated in the past using interferon, ribavirin, and other combination therapy. That cure HCV infection has been associated with a reduced incidence of cases. But patients who achieve a sustained neurological response may remain, or actually remain, at risk for developing hepatocellular carcinoma. Of course, direct acting antivirals have dramatically improved sustained neurological response rates in cirrhotics. But at least until now, very little is known about the effect of these therapies on the possible development of hepatocellular carcinoma. So the aim of our study was a large retrospective core study aimed to evaluate the effect of therapy with direct acting antivirals on the development of hepatocellular carcinoma in patients with liver cirrhosis related to HCV infection. The study population was 344 consecutive HIV negative patients with childhood class A or B cirrhosis. Childhood is a sort of classification of the severity of the dysfunction of the liver, and it is A, B, or C. It is based on different parameters. And we're treated with different DAAs, and we're followed for 24 weeks after therapy end. The diagnosis of liver cirrhosis was assessed by transient elastography, the so-called fibro scan, with a cutoff point of 12, and or liver histology. At baseline, we used contrast-enhanced ultrasonography to exclude the presence of active ACC. And when contrast-enhanced ultrasonography gave no definite result, CT scan and or MRI were performed to confirm the absence that ACC was absent at baseline. Contrast-enhanced ultrasonography was repeated again between 12 and 24 weeks post-treatment. And when a suspected ACC lesion was found, it was confirmed or excluded by CT scan and/or MRI. These are the true data of the occurrence of hepatocellular carcinoma in our population. You can see that. Top, I know that. It's top, but I don't see anything. Oh, top, yeah, I suppose okay, thank you. If we consider the old patients, the old population, the occurrence rate was 7.6%. But you can see that there was a great difference in the occurrence rate of ACC, according with only 3.2% of patients without previous ACC, without a history of previous ACC, and 29% of the patients with the previous ACC. When we look at the population, of the entire population, we can see that the prevalent days, median age was 63 years, there was a distribution of different HCV genotype, of course, the proportion, the majority of patients were infected with the genotype 1. The majority of patients were treatment experienced with previous antiviral treatment based on PET interferon and ribavirin. So, treatment experience without, of course, a biological response in the years before. And the vast majority of patients with childhood A, it means compensated liver disease. And only about 10% had childhood B, that is mildly decompensated liver disease. And the mean liver stiffness value was 23.6. Only a very small number of patients has co-infection with HBS, Hg positivity, which means HB co-infection. And 59 patients, that means 17.2% of our population, had a history of previous hepatocellular carcinoma. Well, we tried to compare the baseline characteristics, differentiating the two population of patients who were without ACC after the EA, so patients who were treated with new compounds and did not develop ACC, and patients who developed ACC after treatment with new compounds. And you can see that as we are probably familiar with the statistical significance, and when statistical significance, the so-called p-value, is higher than 0.05, it means that it's not significant. When it's lower, it means that it's significant. And males, age, diabetes, and body mass index did not differ between patients who had not a new ACC after treatment, antiviral treatment. Patients who developed ACC were more frequently with the more advanced liver disease, this childhood class B. Liver stiffness was higher. And if we perform a ROC curve, so a discriminant analysis of the parts that best discriminate between patients, we found that a 21.3 liver stiffness grade was the best point to discriminate patients with ACC in comparison with patients without ACC. And of course, platelet were lower in patients who developed ACC. Lower platelets means is related to more advanced liver disease. Importantly, we did not find any significant correlation with the genotype. Genotype did not seem to influence the occurrence of ACC. Patients were treated with different genotypes, with different BAAs combination, of course, according to the different genotypes. And again, we did not find any correlation between the occurrence of ACC and the kind of treatment, of antiviral treatment they did. The vast majority, quite 90% of our patients had a sustained virological response, so we didn't expect any influence of response. Our viral response was not associated, of course, with occurrence of ACC. This means that the occurrence was not limited to patients who did not respond or relapsed to antiviral treatment. Also, the previous antiviral treatment, my experience was it was not statistically significant. But of course, the history of previous ACC was the strongest predictor of occurrence of ACC. When we focused on the 59 patients who had a previous history of ACC, so if we extrapolated the 59 patients from the 344 and we look at only the patients with the history of ACC, we found that patients who developed ACC after DAAs were significantly younger, not older, younger, more frequently treatment experience, and of course with a more advanced liver fibrosis. So, in summary, in a large cohort of 344 consecutive patients with ACV-related liver cirrhosis that were treated with direct acting antivirals, antivirals. We obtain an expected sustained virological response of quite 90%. During a 24-week post-treatment follow-up, 26 patients, overall it's at 7.6%, developed HCC. HCV genotype and DIA arrangement did not affect HCC development. The history of previous HCC was the strongest predictor of the development of a new HCC after birth. A more advanced liver disease and younger age were risk factors for HCC recurrence in the subgroup of patients with previous HCC. And the cirrhotic patients should be closely monitored after treatment, and the biological significance of our findings needs to be better defined. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Brillanti. For the sake of time, because we're slightly behind schedule, we have time for a few questions. Who wants to start?
Do you expect more HCC
when
with a
longer follow-up? This is a very good question. I don't know, and I explain you why. If we don't know exactly why patients, we are speaking mainly about patients with the previous histories. These are the risk population. If we don't understand why this had a so high proportion of HCC immediately after, we cannot speculate that this rate may increase or not, because it may also be an effect of if immune surveillance for any reason significantly drops during antiviral treatment or immediately after antiviral treatment, this may be the crude expected rate. And we all can speculate that in the future there is a standard progression of ACC, that's 3% each year. I do not expect to have 30% of ACC every year. So I think that there is a cluster effect, a catalytic effect, and probably I do not expect many more ACC development in the future. Of course, many of these patients will develop ACC on a standard molecular recurrence rate.
Dr. Brillanti, I have a question for you. What was the proportion of your patients with previous HCC that developed HCC recurrence?
Well, this is in our experience.
Sorry, just to give some background to the audience.
A 30% recurrence rate in 3 years is standard.
No, but. Let's go to the point because we're behind the schedule. So the reason why I'm asking is that there is a paper that is in press in Journal of Hepatology coming from the Barcelona group suggesting that there is a close to 30% recurrence HCC rate in patients with previous HCC that are treated with DAA. And the data you're presenting are consistent with this study that has just been published, and this is why I'm asking the question, because you provide 7% in all the patients, but as you mentioned, the fact of having previous HCC, you have a high recurrence rate, so my impression that is pretty close to what has been reported by the Barcelona group as well. Can you confirm?
It's surprising, the number is not similar, but quite exactly the same. We have 59 patients with previous history and 17 had recurrence. They had 58 and 16, exactly the same proportion.
Very, very similar.
And the 7.6% must be split between the 3% of the patients without the history and the patient with the history. So it seems that patients with the previous history have a high risk of recurrence. But we also have to understand that there is a recurrence is physiological, and patients with the previous HCC. And we should expect in 3 years a proportional recurrence. So the question is why so all together at the same time?
No, so following up your question, of course, this is quite an expected rate as early, because recurrence, of course, is quite common, but not as early. And this is suggesting actually of image, a problem with image surveillance.
I think so.
Please.
Greg Jeffries, HepMag, USA. So does your work actually indicate that the sooner a patient with Hep C is treated with DAAs, the less chance there is of them developing cancer?
Patients with I think that it's similar to the question of if there is a delisting or other situation. I think that there is in any chronic liver disease, in any chronic disease, there is a part of no return. That means that there is a part after that, if you also eliminate the cause that initially produced the disease, you cannot alter the progression. So I think that we cannot conclude that DAA may increase the risk of HCC. We can only say that probably there is a proportion of patients with a tumorigenic effect that is ongoing, in which if we alter the immune response following the elimination of the virus, this may as maybe a catalytic effect that may increase the risk in the short time. But probably this patient would develop ACC later. So, because we must be careful about this message, because it's a very strong message. My impression is that we do not augment, increase the absolute number. We probably have